Please stand.
I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
Please be seated for our remembrance.
Good morning. My name is Bailey Player, for those of you who don't know me, which is very few of you, I know. I am the youngest of Tom Player's five children. I'm also an English teacher at Pace Academy in Atlanta. And as a teacher, it's kind of nice to find myself in front of a room of people who actually want to hear what I have to say. It's not something that usually happens. It's a nice change of pace, really. I want to thank all of you who reached out to me and my family with your condolences. So many kind thoughts and touching stories about my dad. I encourage you all to continue to share these thoughts and to tell these stories. They are, after all, his afterlife here on earth. It is how we keep him alive in our memories. And I want you to know that we read them all. All of those emails, texts, letters, posts, and comments. Listen to the voicemails. I don't have time to share them, of course, but they all went into consideration of this remembrance. All of those condolences and anecdotes tended to have one thing in common: remarks of a man who lived large. Tom Player was a big guy. He was large in stature. He was strong. He sculpted well into his 80s. When I was younger, he would give me hugs so tight that he would literally crack my back. He was an athlete. He was a star football player in high school and in college. He was a state-ranked handball player at one point. He was an avid and skilled fly fisherman. He also played golf from time to time. Not exactly the same level of skill, but, you know, he did his best. He accomplished big things. Student body president in college, a captain of Army Intelligence in Korea. He's a founding member of Neely & Player Law Firm, senior partner, Morris, Manning & Martin, and, of course, an award-winning artist. He had big dogs with big names. Bear, Killer, and even Texas. Doesn't get any better than that, right? He didn't buy bottles of wine. He bought cases. If he was going to cook you a steak, that sucker was going to be this thick. He made big fires at the Mountain House, at his beloved beach house just down the way in Sullivan's. He loved nothing more than huge family gatherings. Holidays were always a big affair. I wasn't born yet, but my brothers tell me of a haunted house set up in the garage that terrified all the neighborhood kids. Apparently it was kind of a rite of passage and a badge of honor to make it through the thing. Super Bowl parties, so well attended that you couldn't hear or see the game. And that wasn't really the point anyway. If you wanted that, you just go home. Christmas trees so big that Clark Griswold would have blushed. If he was going fishing, it wasn't going to be down at the creek or the river. It was going to be in Argentina or Andros with one of his sons. His idea of a golf outing was 8 of his buddies, 5 courses in Ireland. Professionally, he was a lawyer. And I know that we have some here, and I want to thank them for their attendance. I know that lawyers can sometimes get a bad rap. My dad once told me that there are really only 3 lawyer jokes, and the rest are all true stories. But he was a lawyer, as he would say, he was old school. He was an advocate. And I mean that literally. In Roman law, an advocate was one whose profession was to plead against injustice. The root of the word is vocare, which means to voice or to call. And literally, an advocate is one who speaks on behalf of another. And he did. My father was an advocate, a mentor, and a teacher. And nowhere was his teaching so much on display as with the legendary Dad School lesson plans. Now, for those of you who don't know, every month, us kids were encouraged to attend one of these classes. Topics might range from the technical, such as how a combustion engine works, very important for a 10-year-old to know, such as how a submarine works, very important for a 12-year-old to know. My sister, Cannon, recalls a more practical lesson involving fire safety. Right. My dad explained what we should do when, not if, but when the house caught on fire. We were all of us edified as to how we should roll the rope ladder out of the second story window in order to be able to climb down to safety. The fact that we had no rope ladders, or the fact that rope is famously flammable, was never addressed, but fortunately we never had to manage such a scenario. Greg remembers a dad school lesson about emotions, where my dad drew faces on butcher paper to indicate certain feelings like joy and shyness and sadness and, yes, grief. The most memorable drawing was anger, pictured as a man so hot under the collar that he had an egg frying off the top of his head. This lesson was about empathy. And empathy was something that Tom Player knew a lot about, something that allowed him to extend dad school beyond his children. My wife, Amber, has spoken often of his empathy and told me that she feels, and still feels, that he was a dad to anyone who needed one, whenever they needed it. Perhaps that is what my mom had in mind when, after I graduated and left them empty nesters, she approached him with the idea that they, in their late 50s, adopt a Romanian child. Why Romanian? I have no idea. Ever the litigator, though, my father responded by saying that Romanians often have large families, and it would be a shame to adopt just the one. And really, if you were going to do it, you'd want to adopt the siblings as well, so two or three or four children. And anyway, it's a big bluff from a big man, and it worked. As far as I know, I don't have any Romanian brothers or sisters. Still, dad school continued, even to those not in our immediate family. I can recall, for example, a conversation between my father and my brother-in-law, James, who's here, both of them military men, James having served as a staff sergeant in the Air Force. And this conversation was so inscrutable, with so many unknown abbreviations to me, so much jargon, that about 20 minutes in, I just got up and left. And I have to say that my absence was neither missed nor was it particularly remarked upon. And then there's Gary, Cannon's husband, who sought my dad's advice, as so many of us did in key moments, when he landed an interview at J. Walter Thompson right at the beginning of his career to work on their Marine Corps advertising account. In this consultation with my father, Gary was all seriousness. It was all primary audience mindset this and American Marketing Association that, until my dad held up a hand and he said, "Yo, Gero," which is what he called him. Nobody, you know, got called their actual name. I hadn't been called Bailey in decades, right? I was "Yo, be man," or "Yo, big." He said, "Yo, Gero, I'm going to stop you right there." He says, "You don't need to talk about any of that. They're going to hire you because they can't find anybody to work for cheaper." He was right. They did. Gary's work with the Marines and my dad's time in the Army became a connection between them as well. His grandchildren also benefited from dad school. They might call it pappy school. His granddaughters, Frankie, Emily, and Kate, his grandsons, Trey, Josh, Beau, and Gray. His influence continues all the way through his life. And then, of course, there is Tom Player, the artist. Now, many of you have commented how remarkable it is that he found a second calling as a sculptor after he retired from being a lawyer. But the truth of it is that he was always exceptionally creative. Consider, for example, the Santa Claus that he cut out of wood and hand-painted that has graced our lawn for 40 years. Or the bikes that he repainted and reimagined for Brett, Jake, and Greg, turning one into a shark, another into a cobra, rather than buying them new ones. And in doing so, making them, of course, the envy of the neighborhood. Or the sketches and watercolors that he created on family trips that made photographs all but superfluous. And we are, in fact, surrounded by his art, most of it big, not only in size, but in the story that each of them tells. Perhaps only a man whose own life story was so full could he himself tell such grand stories through sculpture. Big art from a big man. He was a big man with a big heart, with a big family, who lived a big life. So I'll close with this. I'd like to thank my father, Tom Player, didn't really die. It's just that he was larger than life.
Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Tom. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Reading from the book of Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. "Can I not do more with you, O house of Israel? Just as this potter had done, says the Lord, just like clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel." Amen.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I speak in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I miss my friend. You see, only seeing Tom on an occasional basis, I'm still having those moments when I ask myself, I wonder when he's going to be in town again, and when we can sit and enjoy what we called Episcopal incense together. And then I catch myself, I go, oh, Tom has made his last trip in person to this place that he loved. Tom was scheduled to read at tomorrow's Kirken of the Tartan. He loved that service. A great way for him to celebrate his birthday. As it turns out, we celebrate another birthday for Tom today. And yes, Tom will be with us tomorrow and for every Kirken of the Tartan for years to come. But it's never easy to say goodbye, especially to that large character. Needless to say, there are a few more in the next generation. We won't go there now. But I find it better and easier for me if I have a prop to help me get through this time up front. So, Tom, nothing has changed. You're talking a little less than usual, but we both got our point of view in. You see, we believe that Tom Player was sculpted by God into the special person that he is. Would you not agree that there is only one Tom Player? Sometimes we said that gratefully, but today we say it lovingly. So how do we celebrate this gift in our lives? Acknowledging his creative genius, did you know that in a quiet corner of the crypt of St. Paul's Cathedral, London, there lies a monument to Sir Christopher Wren? The epitaph on the wall above is like the one you can find on the floor under the dome of the great cathedral. And it ends with the Latin words, which translated say, if you are looking for his memorial, look around. My friends, if you are looking for Tom Player's memorial, look around. Yes, look around at all the marvelous works that he created, for sure. But better yet, look around and see the relationships that he sculpted, the family life that he formed, and all that love that he lived. Just look around. Now, Tom, in his life, has given us so much to help us through these darker days. And that's why today, with so much to be grateful for, we must make this today about gratitude and not grief. There is a time to be born. There is a time to die. And I'm not sure for Tom if later would have been better. And so, while we are saddened by his death, we are more grateful for his life. We know he didn't want a long goodbye. You know, Tom Player, where's the drama in a long goodbye? It's a ta-da. It's a moment. We get it. He's Tom to the end. Is there a greater thing to wish for than to be ourselves to the end? In our reading from Jeremiah today, God is likened to a potter, one who sculpts his creation, shaping and reshaping us accordingly. Tom had more than his share of shaping and reshaping in this life. But we would all agree that what we ended up with is beautiful, even with a few of those player rough edges still in place. And like the Apostle Paul, it was time for Tom to finish the race. His faith is mirrored in every piece of sculpture that you see in this place. Tom is still teaching us the faith as we ponder his handiwork, the great Celtic cross. Tom was about good news. The four evangelists are central. In a world of bad news, he was about good news. By the baptistry, the stations of the resurrection, revealing new life even in the midst of brokenness and death. In the garden, St. Martin and the beggar, reminding us that we are here to serve no matter what the price. The Sursum Corda altar, we meet Christ in our darkest moments. He is down there with us, just as he is down there with us today as we find ourselves deep in grief. In the song, Going Home, I hear Tom's voice encouraging us in his journey and our journey, a journey which is from grief to glory. Going home, going home. I'm just going home. Quiet light, some still day, I'm just going home. It's not far, just close by, through an open door. Work all done, care laid by, going to fear no more. Work all done, and care laid by. Just as Tom's sixth word from the cross piece in the garden, it proclaims Jesus' words before he died, it is finished. That is, all is done that needs to be done. Tom's words, it is finished, not I am finished. The task is done. So if you are looking for Tom's memorial, just look around and look deep within and celebrate this great life and love that we were privileged to be a part of. And Tom? Do you have a light? You bet you have a light, because you were our light, and now you glow forever amidst the one true light. Amen.
Thank you.
in the assurance of eternal life given at baptism, let us proclaim our faith and say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For our brother Tom, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection, and I am life.
Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Tom, and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Give to our brother eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints.
Hear us, Lord.
He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation, and eternal life our hope.
Father of all, we pray to you for Tom, and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to him eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Thank you. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints.
Where sorrow and pain are no more, not a sign, but life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind. And we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, not a sign, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Tom. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen.
And we pray, O Lord, support us all the day long of this our pilgrimage, till shadows lengthen and evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, our work is done. Then, O Lord, in thy great mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.